Introduction. Thanks to you all for coming, and I'm actually very glad that you brought up Stephen King, not only because you guys should all absolutely go back to the archives of the Journal on Religion and Public Life and find my 5,000-word essay on Stephen King and theology. It's riveting. But also because in lieu, you know, in our unsettled politics, I thought in lieu of actually doing analysis, I'd just sort of read 40 pages from The Stand tonight to give you guys an idea of where the American future is going. But I forgot my copy. It was very heavy. So instead, I will try and give you a survey of what I think is going on in both of our political parties at the moment, and then finish up by sort of talking slightly more broadly about Europe and North America, sort of the Western developed world as a whole. And this is sort of an unsettled talk, because this is a very unsettled time. And like a lot of people in my profession, political journalism, most of my sort of specific predictions about what would happen in presidential politics over the last 18 months or so were proven to be slightly less than prescient. So even more than usual, while listening to a journalist, you should take almost everything that I say with a grain of salt, because we don't know what is going to happen next. And one of the big lessons of recent political history is that history itself can just get a lot more interesting than you think in a very swift amount of time, and you need to be ready for anything, up to and including President Donald Trump. And here we are. But I thought I'd start by talking a bit about the party and the movement that our president is currently leading, because I am a sort of professional conservative writer. I theoretically know conservatism inside and out. And a lot of people during the year leading up to Trump's election would ask me and other people in my line of work, well, explain how American conservatism ended up nominating a figure like Trump, because of course you can come up with all kinds of reasons in terms of his ideology, in terms of his personal habits and lifestyle choices and so on, why Trump seemed like an uneasy fit for the party of the religious right, the party of economic libertarians, the party of Ronald Reagan's optimism, and so on. And one way, and there are a lot of different ways you can think about how this happened, but one way to think about it is to start with sort of what is American conservatism at its best, at its most idealistic, in the form that even its sort of most dogged liberal opponents would say, okay, I have to concede there's something good and important and necessary for American politics going on there. And one way to think about conservatism at its best is to think of it in terms of a defense of American exceptionalism. And by this, I don't mean sort of American exceptionalism in a sort of chest-thumping, rah-rah, you know, we're better than those lame, limp-wristed Europeans kind of way. Although obviously there is a certain amount of that woven into aspects of American conservatism. But rather I mean a defense of things that are distinctive and have been distinctive about American society for the last 200 to 250 years that most people regard with a certain amount of admiration and think, yes, these are sort of American distinctives and part of our society that don't exist always in other countries but have worked quite well here. And so what is that American exceptionalism? How would you define the things that make America sort of distinctive even within the web of wealthy Western countries? Well, we are a commercial republic. We're a society that has been sort of vigorously capitalist and dynamically capitalist since our earliest days. We are a society that is sort of libertarian in not necessarily a political sense narrowly, but in a sort of broad sense of being suspicious of state power, emphasizing the independence of the individual, emphasizing the need to put limits on state power. We're a constitutional society. We're a society that, you know, has maintained one constitutional order with, you know, obviously some alterations, but one constitutional order over an extended period of time, a period of time in which France has gone through at least 217 constitutions. That's a slight exaggeration, scholars of French history, I apologize, but it does get at, you know, the distinctiveness, again, even within the family of wealthy Western countries, of the sort of persistence of constitutionalism and fealty to a now antique constitution in American history. So we're a commercial republic, we're an individualistic and libertarian society, we're a constitutionalist society, but then we're also a religious and communitarian society in ways that are distinctive in Western history. And this is something that Alexis de Tocqueville famously made note of when he came to the U.S. in the early 19th century, and it's remained the case across decades and generations since then, that the U.S. is, in spite of not, or maybe because of not having an established religion, an established church, the U.S. has had some of the most vigorous religious competition of any modern society, and has maintained, in part because of that competition, a high level of religiosity, even as much of the Western world has grown much more sort of secularized and post-Christian. And then, not overlapping precisely, but linked closely to our religiosity, is our communitarianism, which Tocqueville took note of as well. The fact that even as Americans are skeptical of government power, skeptical of central authority, they also have tended to be very good at bonding together in little platoons, whether it's a religious congregation or an Elks Lodge or any kind of sort of communal communitarian organization, to do some of the work that people assume that the state does in other societies, works of charity and solidarity and education and so on. So these are all American distinctives. And when you think about sort of the organization of modern American conservatism as it developed from the 1940s and 1950s through the 60s and 70s, the Reagan era, and down to the present, whether or not it's always lived up to this ideal, it's tended to cast itself as defending these distinctives against a liberalism that essentially would argue that actually the U.S. should just imitate Western Europe and become more centralized in terms of state power, somewhat less capitalist, somewhat more socialist or social democratic in its economic organization, more secular and less religious in certain ways. And conservatism has tended to say, no, these aspects of American life are good and distinctive and have served us well and are worth preserving and defending. And thinking about conservatism in this way, I think, helps explain some of what from the outside look like sort of the strange bedfellows that you get within the conservative tent. So in certain ways, you know, the libertarian who reads Ayn Rand and imagines himself or herself as this dynamic, heroic entrepreneur building huge skyscrapers and shaking their fist at the sky seems a little different from, you know, the natural law Catholic or the Bible reading evangelical who also ends up in the conservative tent. But if you think of them as bound together by this commitment to American exceptionalism, it makes a little more sense, because the libertarian is committed to the entrepreneurial, capitalistic, individualistic side of American life, and the religious conservative sees himself or herself as defending the religious and communitarian side of America's distinctiveness. And those two things, again, historically, even though they're in certain ways in tension with one another, have also worked together to make America a flourishing and successful society across more than 200 years now. So that's sort of a idealistic portrait of what American conservatism is up to. And if you look at sort of the specifics of the Republican Party's program, sort of starting from the 60s and 70s and continuing through the Reagan era into the 1990s, that program lined up in sort of broad strokes with that sort of philosophical goal. So you had a sort of free market element of the program that said, look, taxes have gotten too high, regulations have gotten there's too much of a net thrown over the American entrepreneurial spirit. We need to bring back growth and dynamism, and so we need to slim down government and, you know, unleash the power of the free market again. That's sort of one aspect, one big aspect of American conservative politics. And over the same period, you have a sort of communitarian side which says, look, you know, the social revolutions of the 1960s, the sexual revolution, the big crime wave that hit American cities in the 60s and 70s, all of these are signs of a society that's lost its religious and communal center. And we need to rebuild that sort of religious and communal solidarity, and we need to do it sometimes while fighting with liberals who think that strict separation of church and state means that you can't have religion in the public square. You know, that's a terrible idea because it's contrary to how, you know, great social reform movements have worked throughout American history. Therefore, we need essentially to empower and invigorate a sort of faith-based, not just faith-based activism, but faith-based political activism. And I'm leaving out foreign policy, but you could in certain ways fold that in as well, because at a certain point, conservatives, especially after World War II and in the Cold War era came to see the image of America as sort of the guarantor of sort of global freedom, the guarantor of democracy and republican self-government against communist and fascist tyranny as part of American exceptionalism as well. And obviously it doesn't have the same deep history in our 19th century, but you could link it to Manifest Destiny and currents in the 19th century. But whether you do or not, clearly by the second half of the 20th century, there was a sort of conservative vision of America as the leader of the free world as part of the exceptionalism that conservatives wanted to defend, again, against this sense that liberals wanted to make America just one country among many arguing or cooperating at the UN, and conservatives said, no, we should be in a leadership role. It's part of our past. It should be part of our destiny in the future. So that was sort of the way that conservatives wed a political vision to a philosophical perspective on what their relationship was to American life and where American life ought to be going. And in certain ways, if you go back to, say, the year 2000 and look at the landscape, political landscape then, you would say, well, this was a fairly successful marriage, right? It was successful in foreign policy. Under Reagan and George H.W. Bush, the Cold War was won, the Berlin Wall came down, America sort of assumed a position as the world's only superpower. It was successful in economic policy. You had tax cuts and deregulation in the late 70s and early 80s, and the economy seemed to be reinvigorated across the 80s and 1990s. And then it was somewhat successful in sort of communal aspects as well. If you, from the perspective of the late 1990s, you could see crime rates starting to come down. There had been some kind of partial religious revival that people associated mostly with evangelical Christianity, but also to some extent with John Paul II and Catholicism. And in general, some of the alarming social trends of the 1970s, rising divorce rates, rising teen pregnancy rates, and so on, seemed to be settling down a bit in the late 1990s. So around the turn of the millennium, around the time that I was in college and probably not enjoying life quite as much as you guys, but maybe close, you could make a strong case that, you know, within the normal limits of politics, American conservatism had had a pretty good run. That has not been the case in the 15 or so years since. It hasn't been the case in foreign policy, where sort of the surge of patriotism after 9/11 quickly gave way to the Iraq War and sort of its unsuccessful prosecution, and then a series of sort of stagnant, simmering conflicts all over the world that we seem to be enmeshed in without ever winning. It hasn't been true in sort of social and communal life, where on the one hand, over the last 15 years, social conservatism and religious conservatism have suffered cultural defeat after cultural defeat, particularly around same-sex marriage, but also on a range of other issues, abortion being basically the only exception. On every other indicator, America has grown steadily more socially liberal over the last 15 years. And over that same period, there's a fair amount of evidence of sort of growing social fragmentation, personal isolation, family breakdown. The out-of-wedlock birth rate is sort of stuck close to an all-time high. The marriage rate has gone down and down. The fertility rate has gone down, especially since the Great Recession. People are having fewer kids than they used to, and so on. So across a range of indicators, the sort of religious communal side of conservatism seems to be losing ground. And then the economy has been stagnant, or rather you could say it's had a couple of bubbles. The tech boom turned out to be a bubble. The real estate boom turned out to be a bubble. And we've been sort of slowly growing throughout the Obama years. But for a lot of Americans, particularly middle and working class Americans, that growth hasn't delivered much in the way of real wage increases. So over this period, the party that sort of defends American exceptionalism has seen, on the one hand, sort of America get less exceptional in certain ways. The things that we thought distinguished us from the rest of the Western world maybe don't distinguish us quite as much. Our growth rates are slower. We're less religious and more secular than we thought we were. Our sort of ability to lead the free world has run into trouble in just about every war we've gotten into in the last 15 years. So America's grown less exceptional, and over the same period, the conservative Republican policy agenda has sort of been running in place. If you listen to Mitt Romney and John McCain and many of the candidates who ran for president in 2016, you would often think that it was still 1980, and they were still speaking the language that Ronald Reagan spoke, where there was no problem that couldn't be solved with, you know, a few more tax cuts and repealing Obamacare, and, you know, something heroic entrepreneurs will create jobs. Mitt Romney's whole spiel about how you didn't build that, which was basically pitched almost exclusively to people who own businesses and had very little to say to wage-earning Americans. The core of the Republican economic message still sounds like the core of the Republican economic message 30 years ago. And the core of the Republican message on social issues has been, you know, sort of overtaken by the liberalization of the culture, to an extent to which Republicans don't really know what to say because they have a base that is still largely comprised of religious conservatives, but 60% of the country now thinks that those religious conservatives are mostly wrong. And so you have this, you have a party in that sense in trouble. The sort of philosophical basis of the party, the idea that there are these exceptional things about America that need to be defended and preserved, have been steadily undercut by real world events, and the party's policy agenda doesn't seem to have much to say to those changes. And into that state, that void, stepped Donald Trump. And it's unclear even now to me how fully conscious Trump was of the opportunity that this presented to him, but whether he sort of thought it through or, you know, was some sort of political savant or some combination of the two, he exploited all of these problems ruthlessly and very, very effectively, and basically ran on a kind of conservatism that we really haven't seen much of in American politics for a long time, and in certain, you know, depending on how you define it, almost ever. He ran on a sort of non-exceptionalist conservatism, a conservatism that basically says America can be an ordinary country, bound together less by sort of constitutionalism or some sort of idea of what America is, and more by the loyalties of blood and soil. That, you know, America doesn't have to lead the free world. We don't have to lead anything. And in fact, we should make sure that all those other countries are paying their dues if we're going to stay in NATO at all. And, you know, conservatism doesn't have to be libertarian. It doesn't have to stand for limited government. I will promise to defend Medicare and Social Security, and I'll promise an amazing new health care plan that will deliver everything Obamacare delivers, only better and cheaper and so on. So Trump ran in many ways against not every Republican orthodoxy, but a great many of them. And in doing so, he spoke to the mood of a country in which that sort of exceptionalist vision of America didn't seem to fit the facts. A country defined more by wage stagnation, foreign policy defeat, social isolation and atomization. And of course, all of this was particularly true within white working class communities who had been undergoing a kind of slow motion social disaster over the last 10 or 15 years that very few people were covering or writing about, that is suddenly, in certain ways, thanks to Trump's election, getting a certain amount of attention. But, you know, in working class white America, it's become clear you've had, for various reasons, essentially a kind of die-off, a rise in suicide rates, an incredible rise in opioid abuse and so on, that's created a sense of total desolation and pessimism about the American future. And that sense is something that, again, the sort of Reagan-era conservative message of exceptionalism and the pursuit of a certain kind of American greatness wasn't going to speak to. But Trump's message of a sort of a different form of greatness, a greatness that sort of looks out for ourselves and takes care of our own, did speak to and was fairly successful. So that's sort of an account of how the Republican Party got Trump, where he came from, and how he ended up as the leader of the party, if not the president. I guess talk a little bit about at the end about what it means for his actual governance, because I think now it's worth saying something then about the liberalism that he ended up confronting in the general election, a liberalism that thought that it could just absolutely crush him, and it seemed at times likely to do so, but didn't in the end. It did end up winning the popular vote, but not by a sufficient margin to deny him the presidency. So what's going on with liberalism? Well, liberalism is having a slightly different sort of crisis. Liberalism, I think, it's useful to think about the state of liberalism as a kind of collision between egalitarianism and cosmopolitanism, right? Which American liberalism likes the idea that basically you can have both. the sort of ideal vision of, I would say, most American liberals of my acquaintance is a world of sort of perfect diversity, but clear economic equality and economic solidarity. A world that embraces every race and creed and class and sexual orientation, and does so while also making sure that nobody falls too far behind, nobody's left behind economically, and economic inequality goes down rather than going up, 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 as it has gone recently. And the difficulty for liberalism is that those two goals are, if not incompatible, at least somewhat in tension with one another. Because the reality, as far as we can tell, is that diverse societies tend to be more unequal societies. They tend to be societies characterized by higher levels of social mistrust. They tend to be societies with weaker and more corrupt welfare states, because people don't trust each other, one, to run the welfare state, and two, to sort of tax and redistribute, because they don't trust that the people who are getting the benefits are people like them and can be trusted with their tax dollars and so on. And the experience of the US over the last 25 or 30 years has generally borne that theory out. The US has become much more diverse thanks to a large and continuing wave of immigration. It has become much more socially diverse because of the sexual revolution and everything that's followed after that. And over the same period, it has become much more mistrustful, with weaker institutions, more paranoia about those institutions, more distrust of government, the press, practically every institution except the military. And lately, although not so much before the last 10 years, but lately increased racial polarization and increasing sort of persistent economic inequality. And liberalism has struggled to figure out what to do about that tension. And I would say in the late Obama years, the tension has become particularly sharp, in part because liberalism has become increasingly dominated by its sort of cosmopolitan upper class, which is to say people who attend elite universities along the Acela corridor and work in Washington, D.C., and New York especially, but also Philadelphia and Boston and Baltimore and cities on the West Coast and Chicago and so on. And these are people who in their own social world feel that they've achieved a kind of cosmopolitan ideal, an ideal of diversity and representation and religious tolerance and sexual and social tolerance and so on. But they are also people who have a strong, because they are an upper class, they have a strong class interest in the economic and social order as it currently exists. And so for them, it's difficult to figure out how to square their class position with their liberal aspirations, basically. And out of that tension comes a lot of the conflicts that I think you saw at work in the Democratic primary. Where in the Bernie Sanders insurgency, you saw an attempt to basically push more economic egalitarianism back into a party that for a lot of Democrats, especially Democrats in different positions around the country, but especially a lot of more working class Democrats, seem to have been defined more and more exclusively by the identity politics of this sort of cosmopolitan elite. And that effort by Sanders in certain ways was successful. One of the interesting things is that Hillary Clinton did end up running on an economic platform that was to the left of where she had wanted to run, I think, and certainly to the left of where her party would have been even under Obama and certainly under Bill Clinton. So in certain ways, there was this sense that the Democratic Party had sort of moved back towards egalitarianism and solidarity in certain ways in its messaging. But in many ways, Clinton herself remained a very poor candidate for a message of sort of economic solidarity and wealth redistribution. And the party also had essentially the problem that the party of cosmopolitanism runs into, where it was seen by many of its former constituents as primarily interested in sort of the new diversity of America and not sufficiently interested in the people who felt themselves, I think fairly accurately, to be being left behind. And so had Hillary Clinton run against a conventional Republican candidate who seemed to be sort of offering, you know, tax cuts for the rich and sort of trickle-down economics and so on, the fact that she'd moved to the left on economics would probably have enabled her to sort of make a fairly successful pitch to some of those voters. But Trump wasn't running that kind of campaign. Trump was running a very un-Republican campaign, basically going around the country and sort of outbidding Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton would go around the country and say, well, I represent a cosmopolitan liberalism in which our cosmopolitan upper class will accept higher tax rates and redistribute them in the form of social programs to your increasingly impoverished areas. Donald Trump went around the country saying, screw that, pardon my language, I'll bring back your jobs. And that was a much more potent and powerful message, especially because Trump combined it with an emphasis on a kind of white identity politics that also set up a what turned out to be a more politically effective contrast than some of us expected with the vision of a sort of cosmopolitan, diverse American future. And so, again, this has left liberals in the wake of Trump's victory arguing frantically about, what do we do? Have we pushed identity politics too far? You know, was the problem with Hillary that she wasn't populist enough? Or was the problem that she was too populist and we should move to the center on economics and try and claim some Republicans who are economic conservatives who are appalled by Donald Trump? But at the heart of these sort of post-campaign Democratic debates, I think, is this inherent tension between being a party of diversity and being a party of solidarity. It may not be an impossible tension to resolve, in certain ways, Barack Obama himself, because he embodied cosmopolitanism and diversity in himself, he, for whatever reason, had an easier time sort of making that synthesis work, and I'm not completely sure why that was, but in general, this tension is going to dog Democrats throughout the next 4 years and going forward. Basically, to what extent is it possible to be the party that sort of thinks that the goal of an enlightened society is to make sure that women and minorities and gay people are adequately represented on the board of Goldman Sachs? How do you square that with being a party that can win, you know, coal miners in West Virginia and disadvantaged voters around the country who don't sort of see themselves, because they're white, as represented in that vision of a sort of glorious pan-racial, pan-ethnic, pan-sexual future? So that's a vision of where the Democrats are. So the Republicans are sort of caught between American exceptionalism and American anti-exceptionalism, and the Democrats are caught between cosmopolitanism and economic solidarity. And then underlying all of this, and sort of creeping in around the edges of both parties, are something that we haven't seen for a very long time, which are actual doubts about the small L liberal order, by which I don't mean liberalism as the Democratic Party, liberalism as left of center politics. I mean small L liberal politics as in, you know, the mixed economy, constitutional government, basically the consensus of the United States and Western Europe since the Cold War ended and really since World War II. And it's still the consensus, right? You know, you don't have really openly fascist or communist political parties gaining that much ground in Europe, with the arguable exception of Greece. A lot turns on definitions. You know, there are a lot of people who would argue that sort of quasi-fascist parties are taking power in Eastern Europe, in Hungary, in Poland, but the parties themselves would dispute that and would say, no, you know, we're liberal Democrats just like you to some extent. But however you parse it, it's clear that much more so than 10 years ago, there is actual activity in our politics that is skeptical of the way we've run things since the Cold War ended. And some of it has sort of a slightly fascist and right-wing authoritarian tinge. Some of the online thinkers who are associated with the so-called alt-right and neo-reaction. Some of it has a far-left socialist and communist tinge. This is, you know, not the Bernie Sanders campaign, although Sanders was much closer to European-style socialism than any recent Democratic candidate had been. But beyond the Sanders campaign, further on the fringes, you have real intellectual activity among sort of young, hip neo-Marxists in a way that, again, wasn't the case when I was going to college and first writing about politics. And that's, even though it hasn't transformed our politics, that has the potential to transform our politics far more than the two crises that I've just been talking about. The crises that the Republicans and Democrats are working through are major crises for each party, but they can be resolved within sort of the norms of Western politics as we've understood them for the last 25 or 50 years. What's happening on the fringes, you know, whether it's sort of the return of reaction on the right or the return of radicalism on the left, has the potential to reshape our politics much, much more, and make them much, much more interesting and much, much more terrifying than they've been for the entirety of my adult lifetime, let alone most of your lives. And the question of whether that will happen turns to a large extent, I think, on what the people running Western countries do with the challenges they're facing over the next 10 or 15 or 20 years. And that starts with the Trump presidency, which I would not say is off to an encouraging start. I would say right now, Trump is sort of demonstrating the problem of sort of having run and taken over a party that still has its older ideology while you're sort of imagining yourself having a slightly new ideology. So, you know, Trump ran on a message of sort of solidarity on healthcare, health insurance for all, better than Obamacare. He's leading a party that thinks Obamacare is socialism and a big part of it wants to unravel it. And so far, he's not doing a particularly impressive job sort of squaring that circle or figuring out how to finesse and resolve that dilemma. And you could imagine that pattern reproducing itself over multiple policy controversies over the next 4 years and making him not so much a dangerous president as a dangerously ineffective president. And I think dangerous ineffectiveness among Western leaders in general, and it might be Trump in the face of the challenges he's facing, it might be Europe in the face of the challenges posed by Russia on the one hand and mass migration from the Middle East on the other, but ineffectiveness generally is what we've seen over the last 15 years from both the center-left and the center-right. It's that ineffectiveness is the reason that people at the fringes are for the first time in a long time talking about alternatives to the Western liberal order. And while right now those alternatives are minor factors in our politics, if somebody doesn't emerge as a more effective leader, be they liberal or conservative or some new combination, those strange ideas on the fringes are going to seem a lot less strange to people. And politics, which has been pretty weird for the last couple of years, could get infinitely more weird by the time most of you guys are as old and balding as I. So I'll end on that note, and hopefully now we can have an interesting conversation about the unpredictable future. So thank you very much. And I'm just going to call on people if they raise their hands. So please raise your hands, because I'll look silly if you don't. Yes.
So you talked originally about kind of reconciling faith and government and bridging that gap between religion and government. But how do we do that in our country today that's full of so many different kinds of religion?
That's a very good question. The question is, how do you sort of reconcile faith and political action in a country with as much religious diversity as we have? And the answer, this will be my answer to most of your questions, is I don't know. I think this is one of the distinctive challenges of this moment is that in terms of sort of religious diversity in the U.S. And religious fragmentation, we're in pretty uncharted territory. And one of the theories of the Republican Party for the last 20 or so years was that we weren't actually in new territory, right? The Republicans sort of thought to themselves that, okay, well, we have this sort of secular elite that's sort of somewhat hostile to traditional religion, but basically there's still a kind of Judeo-Christian consensus in America. And if we just sort of figure out what evangelicals and Catholics and conservative Jews have in common, we can build a sort of, we can, you know, find a kind of religious, not center, but religious center-right that speaks for 60% of the country. That was sort of would have been George W. Bush's theory, right? That sort of he could that there could be a kind of moderate religious right that spoke for sort of a majority of Americans on religious and moral values. And that probably wasn't true then, and it's certainly not true now. You know, this sort of, I think the best way to think of religion in America is imagine a country divided into thirds, right? About, you know, between 20% and 30% of the U.S. is quite secularized, and increasingly so in the last 10 or 15 years, and that includes people who, you know, who sort of occupy the commanding heights of American, of many American institutions, Hollywood, the news media, the universities, and so on. That part of America is sort of Swedish, in a sense, you might say. And then you have another 25 or 30% of Americans sort of at the opposite extreme who are, in certain ways, connected to fairly traditional religious communities, Jewish, Catholic, evangelical, Mormon. I use traditional for Mormons, even though it only goes back 150 years, but by the standards of sort of contemporary debates, they're traditionalists. And these are people who sort of take their religious communities and traditions very seriously as a guide to politics and life. And then you have in the middle, like 30, 40% of America that is sort of, well, the subtitle of my last book was How We Became a Nation of Heretics. And heretics is kind of a loaded word, even at a Catholic university. But if you don't think of it as sort of an excuse to burn someone and just think of it as a descriptive term, it's actually quite useful. And I think a big chunk of Americans are sort of quasi-Christian, Christian-ish, right? They're people who sort of, you know, are, some of them would identify as spiritual but not religious. Some of them would identify as sort of lukewarm Christians of various kinds. Some of them would say, well, I'm experimenting with, you know, a little yoga over here and a little Kabbalah over there. And I like the shack and Eat, Pray, Love. Seriously, Eat, Pray, Love, I think, is actually one of the really important religious documents of our time. It's like Augustine's Confessions for the 1990s, and I'm not joking. That's not a joke. It's actually, I think, a really interesting portrait of sort of religious searching in our age. But anyway, so you have that sort of center, but that center is a grab bag of different, very different sort of competing religious ideas, some of them Christian, some of them New Age, and then sort of speckled throughout, you also have sort of smaller immigrant religious communities, Hindu and Buddhist and Muslim and so on, with sort of Islam as this sort of, generally as sort of this thing out there that a lot of Americans sort of see as a kind of strange, threatening other. That's a complicated religious landscape. And to the extent that there's a center there, it is some kind of sort of very soft Christian-ish spirituality. But there's not a lot of there. And the tendency in our politics, I think, is going to be towards sort of movements on the left and right that don't really have any theological and metaphysical common ground. And that's a new thing, right? Like the civil rights movement, you know, as polarizing as the debates over the civil rights movement were, most of the people involved in those debates assumed certain basically Christian premises that they were sort of trying to argue within. Now, that didn't prevent the civil rights movement from, you know, including violence and terrorism and so on, any more than the Christian common ground of the 19th century prevented us from having a civil war over the same issues. Obviously, just having theological common ground doesn't protect you from conflict. But it's still sometimes a nice thing to have, and we have a lot less of it. And so a movement, you know, movements like Black Lives Matters see themselves as sort of heirs of the civil rights movement, but much more self-consciously secular, not connected to the Black church in the same way. And movements on the right especially are, you know, also, I mean, see themselves as sort of maybe, you know, something like the alt-right might say, you know, well, we like Catholicism because it's associated with white Western civilization, but it's not a religious movement, it's a sort of racial and cultural white identity politics movement. And I suspect we'll see more of that, especially if Christianity, institutional religion, continues to weaken. And, you know, that's a world that does look a bit more like 1920s and 1930s Europe than sort of is is then makes me comfortable, let's say. Yes.
Okay, I have two interrelated multi-part questions.
Excellent.
That but I terrifying. Would, personally, as someone who comes from the Burkean end of the spectrum, would not consider either libertarian nor Trump's non-exceptionalism to be authentic conservative. So the Republican Party simply been hijacked or is in the process of dissolving, falling apart. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, we would not even have an existing conservative party in the United States. Mm-hmm. If we take that, is it possible to reconstitute a conservative party, and how would we go about doing that? That's the first question. Second question is, since Trump essentially took over or captured the top of the Republican Party from the outside and has an agenda which is not supported by many people in Congress, that what do you see him being able to effectively get significant portions of his agenda implemented, or do you think this is going to break down or stall, or do you think that the Republicans will cave in because they need to put some sort of success on the table and follow its agenda? What do you, if you try to look in your cloudy crystal ball, what will happen there?
So second, I'll do the second one first. Trump, you're already seeing it. I think the sort of ideological, both the ideological tension between Trumpism and Paul Ryan conservatism, and the fact that Trump himself doesn't clearly have a strong interest in the details of governing, means that it's going to be really, really, I think, harder than some people expected, and hard to push through a sustained series of legislative, of especially any kind of controversial legislative actions. You know, you don't want to bet against Mitch McConnell's ability to get 51 votes, as somebody said to me from Washington the other day, but it's hard to see how healthcare reform passes in anything like the form that it's in right now. And if that doesn't pass, then it's hard to see how almost anything passes. I mean, there'll be some kind of budget, presumably, and, you know, if you were betting right now, you might say healthcare collapses and they end up doing some kind of extremely modest thing, and they figure out a way to pass a 10-year tax cut that sunsets after 10 years because you can do that without having 60 votes. And so they do that to say they've done something, and then Trump wants to do an infrastructure bill, but to do that, it would have to be a bipartisan bill, and Democrats will have at that point decided, if they haven't already, that they're never giving Trump votes for anything. And that's, you know, that's it, right? I mean, it's not like Trump has six other priorities up his sleeve. A lot of his campaign appeal was saying he wouldn't do things. You know, other Republicans want to reform Medicare. He doesn't. Okay, he can just not do that. And so the analogy, I've used this in the column, so anyone who's read it, forgive me for repeating it, but the analogy might be to Jimmy Carter, right? Jimmy Carter is sort of came in the 70s in tension, in a kind of interesting tension with the rest of the Democratic Party, or with sort of he's remembered as sort of this hapless liberal defeated by Ronald Reagan, but he was actually much, in certain ways, a centrist sort of fighting with liberals in Congress. That's why Ted Kennedy ran against him. And he had, you know, huge Democratic majorities in both houses, and he got nothing done, nothing. And that could very easily happen to Trump. Now, Trump has a better economy than Carter did. On the other hand, Trump is also, shall we say, more volatile and unstable than Carter was. So you could imagine a Carter scenario where, nonetheless, Trump's approval rating stayed in the mid-40s, and because the economy was good and so on, and so he didn't do anything, but people didn't seem to mind, which a sort of Burkean conservative might say would be an instructive example, right? A sort of Coolidge-esque presidency. Or you could see a scenario where he gets nothing done and a few major crises come along that he bollocks up and his administration ends in total disaster. Both of those seem more likely scenarios to me than a scenario where they replace Obamacare, do a major tax reform, do a $1 trillion infrastructure bill, and he runs for re-election as a big transformative success. But so more briefly on the first question, I think, could there be, to the extent that Trump isn't a conservative, could there be a sort of conservative party? Speaking as someone who was part of the anti-Trump contingent among professional conservative journalists and pundits, I think if there's one thing that this election taught us, it's that kind of conservatism is much less popular than we believed, that voters are much less committed to it than than we believed, that people like us have less influence over political conservatism than many. I mean, I write for the New York Times, so I'm sort of a distinctive case. I'm maybe not speaking to the conservative grassroots in quite the same way that, like, you know, some conservative columnists who were anti-Trump thought of themselves. But regardless, I just think the lesson of this year is that intellectual conservatism was sort of an elite phenomenon that succeeded in taking over a political party, but you can't constitute a new political party on the basis of what is essentially the affectation of a few hundred thousand people who subscribe to National Review and the Weekly Standard, which is sort of a pessimistic perspective, but you know, it's been a humbling 18 months. So, yes.
Very much admire your work in the New York Times.
You're very kind.
And I know that you've been arguing for a long time for sort of reform conservatism, so you've been arguing for a conservatism that has a broader appeal than you have a middle class or working class appeal.
Right.
I guess I have a sort of two-part question. One, how much potential do you think that it has in the age of Trump? And secondly, do you think that that sort of reform conservatism would have a broader appeal to people across ethnic lines? So, you know, you're mentioning
right.
some of the racial and ethnic divides that are going on. So, I was wondering if you could see that in your mind.
Right. So the answer is I see Trump as God laughing at reform conservatism while vindicating us, I guess. So, you know, I and people of my persuasion had argued for about 12 to 15 years that the Republican Party, because of some of the trends I was talking about, needed to focus more on economic solidarity. And different people had different ideas for what that meant, and I'm not sure all of our ideas were actually good ones, but we did have some ideas, and our theory was that this was sort of also a better way for the Republican Party to adapt to a more diverse America, because there were a lot of African-American, Hispanic, and Asian-Americans who were, you know, if not sort of obviously Jerry Falwell-type religious conservatives, sort of broadly speaking culturally conservative, who were not attracted to the Republican Party, in part because they associated it with racism, and in part because they felt it didn't speak to their economic interests, basically. And, you know, the racism aspect is something that, you know, is sort of its own issue. But at the very least, having a message of that sort of focused more on economic solidarity would be a way to, you know, a different way to win more Hispanic votes than just passing immigration reform and doing nothing else, right? A different way to win more African American votes than the non-existent strategy Republicans have had. So that was our theory, basically, that you could have a kind of what you would call like a kind of pan-ethnic economic nationalism that would, you know, still be sort of free market focused, still include religious conservative elements, but would sort of focus more on the middle and working classes than the Republican agenda did. And Trump came along and basically sort of proved us right in certain ways about the economic side of the picture by basically proving that you could run for the Republican nomination and win while violating various conservative economic orthodoxies while offering a promise of greater solidarity. But one, he did that with specific economic policy ideas that were, I think, are sort of half-baked and bad for the most part. And two, he did it while yoking it to, you know, I mean, you can sort of go around and around about just how racist the Trump campaign was, but Trump started his campaign by doing sort of birtherism, basically, for a year and change. And then, you know, sort of, I think, fairly deliberately throughout the campaign did kind of winks and nods to white racists without sort of, you know, without saying, I'm a white racist, and, you know, obviously if you press, but his campaign was very happy, I think, to sort of be understood as sort of elbowing people in the ribs in a way that Republican politicians had sort of been doing less and less of going on 20 or 25 years. And so in certain ways you could say the lesson of the Trump campaign is that actually this kind of sort of conservative politics of solidarity inevitably ends up being sort of racially exclusive, basically. And that this goes back to the point I was making about cosmopolitanism and egalitarianism being in tension. You could say that, look, you know, if you get a more egalitarian conservatism, it's going to be less diverse. It's going to be more focused on sort of, you know, protecting white Americans from the threat of immigrants and African Americans. And that's the lesson that a lot of my liberal friends take from the Trump campaign. I still think that a different scenario is possible and plausible. I still think that you could do a version of what Trump did, a more solidaristic economic message, without the birtherism and racist dog whistles. And honestly, I think the fact that Trump did everything that he did around race and still did just as well, I mean badly, but just as well with blacks and Hispanics as Mitt Romney, that suggests that effectively his economic message sort of and the race and the sort of race baiting sort of were a wash in a way with minority voters. He won a few more on the economics and lost a few more on the racism. And that to me suggests again that there's maybe more room to grow for a Republican Party with minority voters that could, you know, yeah, essentially preserve the solidaristic side of Trumpism without the racism. But that's a theory. Trump is reality. And the reality, you know, since he's been elected, it's been sort of short on economic solidarity and long on sort of gestures that are meant to basically just sort of appeal to white identity politics, I'd say, so far. So again, in theory, Trump could offer vindication and a blueprint. In practice, he's offering something darker, I'd say. Yes.
So, I know you didn't want to talk about foreign policy.
No, it's okay. It's just, it's a big world.
Yeah. But one of the things that I've been thinking about in connection with these trends, of course, is the Cold War, and not anymore Cold War.
Right.
But we've got now, right? And with the Cold War, not only did you have something that held together the coalition on the right, but you had something that made the program of expanding global capitalism, in to a certain extent, something that everyone could be on board with, even on the left, just right in certain ways, as a kind of, you know, sense of freedom and individualism. And there seems to be a sense in which there's a lot more zeal now, after the Cold War, for the expansion of global capitalism in the elite part of the left than anywhere else, right? The Tom Friedman kind of
center left, I think. In the center left. Not the sort of emergent to the new left or whatever you want to call it.
It's more comfortable with the
leadership of the Democratic Party, certainly, yes.
It's not strongly egalitarian. It's essentially however much it may be possible to, you know, fool yourself about it, it's a kind of oligarchic program. How would you characterize the situation of America vis-a-vis the world with the Cold War out of the picture? Is there any kind of summing up of how we see ourselves in relation to the rest of the world, or is it just splintering apart?
I mean, right now it just seems to be splintering. I would say that it's been interesting to watch the role that Russia has played in sort of the American imagination and lately the liberal imagination, because I think it's a sign of how sort of ideologically unstable our politics is, that we could go from 4 years ago Mitt Romney being laughed at by liberals for saying Russia was our number one geopolitical foe, to Donald Trump being nominated as the Republican Party's candidate while promising détente with Russia, and having, you know, and having liberals respond with talk of a new Cold War and sort of the accusations that have led to the spectacle on Capitol Hill we had today. You know, and again, some of that is particular to Trump. Obviously, only Trump in certain ways could have done certain things, but he couldn't have done what he'd done if there wasn't this inherent instability where we don't know who, I mean, like you said, it's people want to define themselves against something, right? If we're the leader of the free world, well, what is the free world defined against? And one answer after 9/11 was jihadism and radical Islamic terrorism. And another answer that was sort of existed among on the center right, but also on the center left, and now is stronger on the center left, is that there's this axis of authoritarianism that's sort of resurgent, and Putin is sort of the embodiment of it, and we're defining ourselves against that. But then that coexists with another sense on the left that, you know, no, actually the danger is that Trump's going to start a war with China and that he's too belligerent and so on. And again, some of this is a reaction to Trump himself, who does contain multitudes. You know, he could make peace with Russia and start a war with China. That's actually quite plausible. But regardless, you know, I mean, and Russia has sort of, some of the anti-Russia rhetoric on the center left has been sort of new Cold War type rhetoric. Some of it, though, has reflected the fact that Russia is, you know, if liberalism is about cosmopolitanism, Russia is now sort of the locus of reactionary energy in the world. So in certain ways, it would make sense that Russia would be more of a boogeyman on the center left than on the center right, and certainly more than on the right. So in certain ways, you could say Trump, by virtue of his distinctive relationship to Russia, has accelerated a process that was already happening, where a right-wing Russia was destined to become the terror of sort of centrist globalist liberals, while sort of people on the further right were more likely to make excuses for it. But I mean, I think certainly the underlying dynamic worldwide is a sort of general rebellion against globalism and a reassertion of nationalism and national identity. And it's not just that Trump is similar to what's happening in Western Europe, it's that he's similar to, you know, Erdogan and Modi and figures all around the world. And the question is, does that, there are a lot of questions, but what, you know, one question is, well, what is America's role in a world that's defined more by competing nationalisms and by ideological tension? The second question is, at what point, right now a lot of those competing nationalists are allies, right? They're sort of a nationalist international that, you know, is sort of from Putin to the far right in Europe, but also, you know, to I mean, there was a small but notable block of Hindu support for Trump, for instance, that I think is connected to sort of interesting affinities between Trumpism and sort of Hindu nationalism in India. So you have this sort of, as long as there's a sense that sort of the globalists are running the world, you can have this sort of pan-ethnic nationalist solidarity of nationalisms. But that only can last for so long, right? I mean, Poland and Russia are both now run by very nationalistic forces, and those forces are not in alliance with each other. So it does seem like a world, I guess the question is globalism strong enough that it can always sort of hold nationalism like this, in which case the nationalisms will continue to be aligned against the globalists? Or just do we reach a point, and Trump's victory suggests it might be more plausible than we thought, where the nationalisms start really taking power, and suddenly, you know, I mean, globalism can just collapse, right? It collapsed after World War I. There was sort of the sort of whole globalist idea was essentially non-existent between 1914 and the United Nations. We talk about the League of Nations. But anyway, so this is why if we get into foreign policy, my ideas are even more informed. But it's a very sort of unstable and hard to predict situation. Yes?
So for many of us, this was our first time voting in an election.
Congratulations, it's always like this.
just being introduced into the electorate. So I wanted to ask, what do you say to the presumably fiscally conservative, socially liberal, maybe 18 to 22 year old that somewhat feels defeated?
Well, first of all, so this has been a very dark view in certain ways of, you know, it's like, well, both parties are in crisis, you know, radicalism is creeping in around the edges, the nationalists will all be at war with each other and so on. with all that being said, one, you know, America is still at peace, and the world, while it has more wars than it did recently, is still relatively at peace, and the U.S. economy is growing, and for all of sort of the madness of this election cycle, you know, it still pales in comparison to what was going on when my parents were in your position casting their first vote, right, in the late 60s, early 1970s. Like, you know, people freaked out about violence at Trump rallies and what just happened at Middlebury and so on, and people are right to freak out about it. It's a very bad sign when violence of any kind edges back into our politics, but we're still a long way from the worst it's been in modern American history, which is nothing compared to the worst it's been in global history. So that alone should give you some reason, regardless of your politics, but if you feel politically homeless and sort of defeated by what just happened, it should give you sort of a baseline of sort of, if not optimism, at least sort of a baseline for being non-apocalyptic about what's going on. And, you know, I write for the New York Times, I have a lot of liberal readers, there's a lot of apocalyptic thinking among my readership. And, you know, I mean, Donald Trump is a very volatile and unstable man, and he does control the U.S.'s nuclear weapons in some sense. So there's, you know, there's more reason to be fearful than usual on that score. But I would urge you not generally to give in to a sense that the world is ending with every story you read about something crazy happening in politics. And I would especially urge you, on when you're on social media, to not let that sort of stream of madness and outrage and can you believe what happened today sort of distract you from the reality that most of your life is not about politics and shouldn't be about politics. I mean, I write about politics for a living, and most of my life isn't really about politics. And as, you know, and I mean, you're young, and, you know, relatively young, but as you get older, I can speak from at least a little bit of experience. You know, if you have a happy and flourishing life, you will find that the sort of all-consuming aspect of American electoral politics occupies a smaller and smaller portion. And it's a sign of a healthy society that that can be the case. And in certain ways, that's what we're all working for, a society where you don't have to think about politics all the time. So, yeah, I mean, my advice for you would be, one, you know, be concerned about the situation, as I am concerned, but don't give into apocalyptic thinking. And two, remember that if things go reasonably well, you shouldn't have to think about politics all the time, and it is probably healthy for you if you don't. And third, socially liberal and fiscally conservative. No. Socially conservative and fiscally liberal is the cool new thing that you're going to want to pick up. That's a joke. Well, it's not really a joke, it's the truth, but it's also a joke. So, yes.
So, two questions. One regarding what we see, so two things that we haven't talked about very much. One is what's happening in the states. So we see, in many cases, unified Republican governments. We see governorships in about 30 or so of the states. You see figures like Rick Snyder, John Kasich, Charlie Baker in Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
So you see Republicans at the state level, perhaps would have been some here in this room, different from what we see at the national level. So what impact do conservatives or Republicans at the state level end up having on national politics? Do they end up emerging as candidates currently or in the future? That's one. And then second, especially given that we just started the hearings for New Gorsuch, what role does the court play in all of this? I mean, we have to think about the role that the 5-4 decision in terms of same-sex marriage had an attitude to the country towards that. So going forward, if the court, the composition of the court changes, does that have a different effect? Does that have an effect on how the body politic shapes? I mean, we can think about 1930 and the Roosevelt Court and so on.
Right.
So again, the Supreme Court is an important institution that might affect.
Yeah, well, so to the first question, I mean, I think Republicans at the state level are, in certain ways, more in tune with their constituents, in many cases, than Republicans at the national level. And that has a couple of consequences. I mean, it can mean that in sort of very conservative states, they're more likely to sort of conduct starkly ideological experiments of the kind you got in Kansas with Sam Brownback and so on. But it can also mean that they sort of pick up on things that the National Party hasn't picked up on yet. And I think in certain ways, some of the Midwestern governors especially picked up on, the sort of economic and social anxiety that made Trump appealing was sort of more manifest in the way John Kasich ran Ohio than it was in the way that Ted Cruz campaigned for president. Now, of course, Kasich still got, Trump still wiped the floor with him, which tells you maybe something about the sort of political limits of that at the national level. But I think in general that, the state level Republican Party has been sort of healthier and sort of more effective at a policy level than the National Party for a while. And that's probably likely to remain so. And I'm not, there are also some complexities, right? Like, one of the things about the state level politics is that state level Republicans have had public sector unions as a foil. And public sector unions, it's a case where, as a conservative, you can make the sort of, a very ideologically comfortable argument about why public sector unions, are bad, basically, while also sort of appealing to average middle class voters by saying, look, these are sort of special interest groups that you don't belong to that are sort of swallowing the state budget and, requiring higher taxes and so on. And that's what Scott Walker ran on in Wisconsin, it's what Kasich ran on up to a point, it's what Chris Christie did back when he was popular a long time ago. There's no equivalent of that, though, at the national level, because there aren't major, there aren't public sector unions. That's not, Washington's deficits are driven by very popular entitlement programs, you don't have some, you don't have some sort of liberal interest group that you can run against. Medicare recipients are not a liberal interest group, they're just older Americans, right? And so I think that in part does explain part of why Republicans at the state level have been more successful than at the national level, because at the state level you can say, I'm a traditional small government guy, here's my case against public sector unions, a lot of voters will listen to you. The national level, you're like, I'm a small government guy and I guess we got to cut Medicare, and people are like, well, I'm not sure about that. And you had a second part of your question that was about the Supreme Court, right? So, clearly one of the reasons that a lot of, especially evangelical Christians and social conservatives, voted for Trump when they didn't really want to was the sense that the court was in the balance. And I think the court, one of the things that's happened in our politics is that the court and the presidency have both become steadily more powerful as Congress has sort of atrophied and Congress has sort of ceded more and more power to both of them. So, Congress doesn't amend the Voting Rights Act, the court does, right? Congress doesn't pass same-sex marriage, the court does. The Republicans in Congress decide, well, I guess the court will save us from Obamacare. Again and again on both sides you see the party sort of saying, hoping, well, the court will do something rather than Congress having to do something. And that, I think, definitely contributes to polarization, because the presidency appoints the court, right? So you have the two most powerful bodies sort of bound together. A vote for the presidency is a vote for the court. So suddenly the stakes in every presidential election are effectively doubled, and Congress then continues to atrophy. So in certain ways, the best thing for the country going forward would be, I would like Anthony Kennedy to flip on Roe v. Wade. And other than that, keep the court exactly as it is in perpetuity. Right. That's a joke. But just in terms of, sorry, my jokes are, but just in terms of political stability, any swing of the court, any situation where a justice dies becomes this sort of apocalyptic life and death moment for both sides. And that's not at all a healthy thing for the Republic. And I don't see how you sort of escape it at the moment. The Gorsuch battle won't be that big a deal because he's replacing Scalia, right? So the balance stays the same, so everybody doesn't have to freak out. But, that's not going to be the case necessarily in the next battle. And there, the stakes really are high. They're connected to presidential elections. And it's hard to sort of, once a body has sort of claimed a certain amount of power, it's hard to figure out how to walk that power back. All right.
I think it's probably time to wrap up. We do have some refreshments outside, so if you want to continue the conversation, that's great. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, guys.